There seems to be no end of confusion surrounding the question, why do seismologists change the magnitude of an earthquake? Magnitudes aren't simply pulled out of a hat, yet the downgrading, or in the case of larger earthquakes, upgrading of an earthquake's magnitude are understandably misinterpreted. Are seismologists hiding something? The Global Seismographic Network, along with thousands of other seismograph stations worldwide, record seismic waves released by an earthquake. Data from each earthquake are recorded in real time and either transmitted immediately by telecommunications to a data management facility or stored for future analysis. Much of the stored data is accessible to anyone who requests it. The National Earthquake Information Center operates a 24-hour service that issues reports in near real time for magnitudes greater than 3 in the U.S. or magnitude 5 anywhere else in the world. These are just a fraction of the millions of smaller earthquakes detected and located by seismic networks each year. Obtaining an accurate preliminary magnitude can be difficult, due not only to the complex processes that occur deep within the Earth, but because there are over a dozen techniques for calculating the magnitude of an earthquake. Some methods give approximate values within seconds of the earthquake, while others require more complete data sets and extensive analysis. Computers use the preliminary amplitude and arrival times for P, S, and surface waves from multiple seismograph stations to derive an initial magnitude and location. Since the amplitude of a seismogram is largest near the earthquake, corrections must be made for distance from the hypocenter, which is the place inside the Earth where the fault actually breaks. Seismograms recorded close to the earthquake can be a complicated superposition of P, S, and surface waves, whereas distant seismometers are able to record a more predictable signature due to the P and S body waves that traveled through the mantle and the slower surface waves that travel near the Earth's surface. Calculating an earthquake's magnitude also requires measuring other characteristics of the earthquake, such as the fault orientation, frequency, and rupture duration, with additional adjustments made specifically for what kind of soil and the local geology that the station sits on, and how the waves traveled through the Earth. Also factored in are the characteristics of the seismograph that measures and records the earthquake, including whether it records three components or three directions of movement, and what type of waves the instrument is calibrated to record. Each method of determining magnitude has its own limitations. Two examples are the Richter and moment magnitude scales. The Richter magnitude, recorded on a certain type of seismograph that was common in the early 20th century when this scale was developed, relates the maximum amplitude of the seismic waves plotted against distance, which is calculated by S minus P arrival times. Connecting the two gives the Richter magnitude. This scale is good for local, smaller earthquakes below magnitude 5, which produce most of their energy as short-period, high-frequency waves, but the scale is not as effective for larger earthquakes. The moment magnitude is based on the lowest frequency data recorded on modern seismometers and can be related to the distance the fault moved, the area of the moving fault, and the rigidity or strength of the rocks on both sides of the fault. It thus measures the size of an earthquake in terms of the total energy it released. The larger the earthquake, the more energy is released at lower frequencies that are associated with damaging surface waves. The moment magnitude scale works well for large, long-period, low-frequency, distant earthquakes. This is the most common measure for earthquakes greater than magnitude 5. The 1989 Loma, Prieta, California earthquake had an original Richter magnitude of 7.1. In areas where structures were built on unconsolidated sediment, the shaking was severe. Several years later, it was downgraded to a moment magnitude of 6.9 on the basis of more detailed studies of the various types of shockwaves generated, combined with the extent of slip along the San Andreas Fault and new methodologies. Far from downgrading the power of past earthquakes, the moment magnitude concept simply includes in its calculations the results of years of research findings about how earthquakes behave. Revised estimates of magnitude do not mean that the quakes were any less destructive. To complicate the initial magnitude picture, large earthquakes are not simply local fault breaks, but are often a cascading sequence of breaks along a long fault rupture. The Tohoku earthquake was initially reported as a magnitude 7.9. However, that was just the onset of a 500-kilometer-long rupture that was to continue for 3 minutes. It was quickly upgraded to a magnitude 8.8, then to an 8.9, and finally to a magnitude 9. 5 years later, when all the data were in, it was ultimately classified as a magnitude 9.1, the fourth largest earthquake ever recorded. The reason it took so long to determine the magnitude is because the larger the earthquake, the more complex are the seismic waves that are recorded from the earthquake. In addition, surface waves can be more prominent farther away from the earthquake, in contrast to body waves that tend to die off or attenuate at greater distances from the hypocenter. Determining an earthquake's exact magnitude once took weeks, but now seismologists, using sophisticated computers, can crunch the data in minutes to hours for small quakes, and hours to days or weeks for great earthquakes. Remember, if you see different magnitudes reported for the same earthquake, it's important to note that sometimes what appears to be a smaller magnitude may actually be a different magnitude scale. In closing, part of the confusion about magnitude lies in the fact that every earthquake has one magnitude, but many different intensities.